Thank you, Mandy. Right, we're now going to sing, so please stand if you can. A nice rousing song, "Give Thanks to the Lord, our God and King." So stand if you can. Questions Jesus asked, and I want us to think about questions today. Questions about the church family. Are we a church family? In some senses, yes. Is it like a normal family? Not really. But there's some parallels. We're all sorts of mixed ages, and there should be like a bond of loyalty to members of the family, shouldn't there? I think there should. There you are. There's the youngest member of a family there. Someone's got to look after the little one, haven't they? So Jesus' question was, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? There's loads of questions, isn't there, hey? In the world, when will the Ukraine war end? Will it end? How hot is our world going to get? And what can we do about it? National questions. Who's going to be our next prime minister? How long will this drought go on? How high will inflation go? And then there's like sporting questions. Will Grimsby Town survive in the National League 2? Or will they get relegated again? Please. Who's going to win the Premiership? And then you've got your personal questions, haven't you? In your own families. For me and Rainey, it's how long will Brenda, her mum, be with us? That's the serious question. And for another one for me, what is my brother going to do? My brother's now back at home. Is he going to cope on his own? I'm actually going down in about 10 days to see him. And there's church questions, isn't it? That's what we're thinking about, really. So next Sunday is Ivor and Carol's last week. Or Ivor's no longer going to be official pastor. Have we got a replacement pastor? That's the question, isn't it? And the answer is no. So what do? Will we keep going? What's going to happen here at BCC? So, two questions to think about. Not really related. What would you like me to do for the church family? That's twisting the question there. What would you like to do for the church family? And the other question, do you believe in pixies and fairies? There you are, didn't expect that question, did you? Do you believe in pixies and fairies? Well, there are some answers, okay? When Ivor and Carol go, for the next sort of 6 weeks on and off, we've got a series starting, and Steve, remember Steve Parker, who came here to possibly be pastor, come and lead us in a series of 6 talks, which I think I'm quite excited that it could really help us. Questions which people might ask, okay? And then on the Wednesday after he's spoken on the Sunday, we're going to, at the Hope Centre, discuss the question. All right, I'm going to just list, tell you what questions will be in a minute. So we're going to probably extend it a little bit. I know Steve thinks an hour in the Hope Centre is not long enough, is it, Steve? I think you've made that point. Yeah. And so we're going to go with that. We're going to have a bit longer, enough time for discussion and then prayer. So, and I think it will work better if we can get ourselves to the Hope Centre, that's my personal opinion, if we're discussing stuff, all right? So the questions, these are questions which people out there in the real world ask about why we bother meeting in church on a Sunday. Why we bother at all? One, is there anyone there? The existence of God. Is Jesus history? Can we trust the Bible? What's so special about Jesus anyway? What about all the rest of the faiths and stuff like that? The uniqueness of Christ. Why create a world like this? The problem of suffering. Why should people suffer? If there's a God out there? Now, there's not going to be every answer given, but it's going to help us out, I think. Is there a right side of history? The future of the world. And I missed one out. Is Christianity toxic? Ooh, the hypocrisy problem. Hypocrite. You do that on a Sunday, I know what you're really like. Is Christianity toxic? Ask what you can do for the church family. Come along, keep meeting. I think it's going to be good, but come along anyway. If we support each other as a church family, everything will be better. We need to be extra supportive of Chrissy. I mean, all the stuff going on, the holiday club, people are supporting. Come along to Cleethorpes. Come along to the time of prayer when you can. If we believe in the power of prayer, if we believe we're doing God's work here, we need to ask for God's blessing, don't we? Pray for the new pastor situation, that there is a person out there who's going to lead us forward. And then what's going to happen with them? If there's nobody around, you know, things happen. And who would you normally call? Who are we going to call? Now, Scylla, next week, is going to tell us, go through like a little scheme she's got of how we can support each other in groups in a meaningful way, okay? And she's in a Scylla's great way with illustrations, because we live in a very individualistic society, don't we? Me and my family, and somehow or other we've lost the idea of caring for each other, but we must buck that trend. In the New Testament, when they were meeting together, they met as one and had all things in common, which is rather amazing, isn't it? And we've gone a long way from that, haven't we? But we need to somehow practically be accountable to each other. It's a bit scary, that, isn't it? I love having my own autonomy in my life, my choice, I'll do my way. But that's not God's way, is it? It's not God's way. One more question, wasn't it? Do you believe in pixies and fairies? Do you remember your mother, you know, when said, well, you know, who's going to set the table? Who do you think normally sets it? Fairies? Anyone get that? Or was it just my mother? Well, this morning we are missing the pixies called the Perkins. All right? Now, I'm about to label myself as a big fairy, but that's the... Because I was here. The table and chairs don't just arrive. All this stuff here hasn't just arrived by the fairies. Because as well as the pixies and fairies, we're going to miss the leprechaun. Yeah? You look, this is Wikipedia. Now tell me if this is not either. This is description of a leprechaun, all right? A diminutive supernatural being in Irish folklore, classed by some as a type of solitary fairy. They used it, usually depicted as little bearded men. I give you either. Wearing a coat and hat, well, sometimes, who partake in mischief. I give you. And well, we're going to lose Mr. and Mrs. Leprechaun, aren't we? What's going to happen? I'll still be here setting stuff out. We're going to be struggling. Mandy's here now, sort of like coming. Nabil's on holiday this week, but between them, I know people are stepping up, but we need to encourage each other to do things. Things don't just happen, because I don't believe in fairies either. And I only half believe in leprechauns in a non-serious way. All right? But so next week, all right, that's their last week here, because things really, they just do not just happen. The organisation had 3 meetings this week to try and sort out how we're going to keep things on the road. When Scylla talks about how we're going to do these supportive groups so that people aren't isolated when things happen. I mean, there's all things happening in our lives, isn't there? Yeah, some of which I've got no idea about what's happening with people, but there's all sorts of things going on. And we need to be vulnerable enough and caring enough to support each other. We don't believe in pixies, but I do want us all to come together, support the church family, come along Wednesdays and Sundays, support Chrissy, come and pray, and join with us next week to say goodbye to the leprechauns. Heavenly Father, we thank you that there are youngsters here, and we pray with those who are now going to go out with them that they'll have fun, but and able to get some of the words of Jesus across to them. Be with them this morning as we carry on in our service here. Amen. Thank you.
fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Father God, we come before you now, humbly acknowledging your greatness, your power and authority. For you made the heavens and the earth and all that is in them. Yet you have set your sight on man whom you have created, with whom to have a relationship. We are unworthy, and we acknowledge our sin before you and ask for your forgiveness. Forgive us, Lord, for the sins we know of and those of which we are unaware. Thank you for the cleansing blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us on the cross. We bring to you those close to us, asking for your help and favour on our friends and family, including our church family. We pray for the summer events, including the children's event this coming week, that your name will be lifted high and that children and adults alike will be drawn to you. We pray for our Pastor Ivor and give thanks for him and for Carol and for all they have done for us as a church in these past 3 years, which have passed so quickly. We pray a special blessing on them as they move on to the next phase of their lives and their ministry for you. We pray for the leadership team and those tasked with finding a new pastor. Please help and guide us, Lord. We bring our government before you and our country as our government seeks the way forward in these difficult times. May they make wise decisions. Help us, Lord, as a country to recover from the effects of the COVID crisis, as we pray the same for other countries suffering similar situations. We remember our Queen and the royal family, and we thank you for the steadfast faith of our Queen, and we pray you'll keep her strong. We pray for leaders around the world as they seek to respond to the Ukraine crisis, and we ask for peace in that country to be re-established as soon as possible. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem and for your people in that country. Lord, we lift before you those who mourn in our company, and especially we remember Rainey and the family in their loss of Gordon, Jean in her loss of Michael, and Dawn and her family in their loss of Addie. Please comfort them, we pray, and strengthen them. We pray for those who are less well, and we think of Anne in Peaks Cross, Croft, as well as Tony, cared for so ably by Kate. We pray for Dean too as he recovers, and Emma. Strengthen and help them, we pray, and that they may know your close presence, we ask. And finally, we pray for ourselves, that we will walk close to you in fellowship with you and each other, looking out for one another and witnessing in our daily lives to your amazing goodness to us. In the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.
As Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jericho, a large crowd followed him. Two blind men were sitting by the roadside, and when they heard that Jesus was passing by, they shouted, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us." The crowd rebuked them and told them to be quiet, but they shouted all the louder, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us." Jesus stopped and called them. "What do you want me to do for you?" he asked. "Lord," they answered, "we want our sight." Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes. Immediately they received their sight and followed him. Amen.
Speak, O Lord, as we come. Thank you. Jackie, for choosing that particular hymn that we've just sung, because that is the key to what we're about in this church, I believe. We want to proclaim God's word, and we want God to speak to us through his word. And perhaps particularly relevant to our passage today is that line in the second verse, cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see. That's what we want. We want to see Jesus. As we have prepared this series on questions Jesus asked, some of the leadership team know that I've struggled with which of the questions that Jesus asked we should select. And I did look at the question for this week, what do you want me to do for you? And the question for next week is, what do you want? And I thought, those are very similar, but they're different, as we'll see as we unpack this. So this week we have, what do you want me to do for you? And last week we had a rhetorical question. We had a question that Jesus wasn't really expecting a specific answer. This week, he does expect an answer. And it's curious, this question, as we'll see as we unpack it. Slides. But there are three points that I want to bring to you. And they are at the crowd in verses 29 and 31. The clarification. Because as I say, this is to some extent, it's a strange sort of question. So we need clarification of that question. And thirdly, the compassion. And I hope you'll get excited as you see the compassion in Jesus through these few verses. First of all, the crowd. Just reminding you of these verses. As Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jericho, a large crowd followed him. Two blind men were sitting by the roadside, and when they heard that Jesus was passing by, they shouted, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. The crowd rebuked them and told them to be quiet, but they shouted all the louder, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. Just to give us a picture of where we are, you remember from the last couple of weeks, you'll see that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. This confession from Peter, you are the Messiah, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, was a real turning point in Jesus' ministry. He was coming down from the north, see the red line coming down, and he reached the town of Jericho here. Not very far from Jerusalem. You'll see that there are a couple of events happened at Jericho. He healed the blind man, blind Bartimaeus, it says here. We'll deal with that in a minute. And he leads Zacchaeus, the tax collector, to repentance. And if you're at the holiday cruise on Tuesday, there'll be a little bit of a story about Zacchaeus there. Both of those things happened in Jericho. And it was coming up to Passover time. So a lot of people would have been going up to Jerusalem for the Passover, for this feast. They were getting together in Jerusalem. And so there would have been a lot of people going along this road, hence the crowd that followed Jesus. They were going west, and perhaps some of these people in the crowd had heard about Jesus. They had heard that he was a healer, and they had things wrong with them, and they wanted to get healing from Jesus. And there were all sorts of reasons why the crowds might have been there. Might have been just going to Jerusalem. Probably most of the people would have been Jewish people making their way there for the feast, but they might have wanted to be healed by Jesus. And we'll come back to the crowd a little bit later on, but the crowd, the clarification. The crowd rebuked them and told them to be quiet. But they shouted all the more. Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. Jesus stopped and called them. What do you want me to do for you? Let's stop at that point. These men, other accounts in Mark's Gospel and Luke's Gospel tell us that they were begging. In fact, as I've already alluded to from a previous slide, in one of the other Gospels, there's only one blind man mentioned, and that is the son of Timaeus, or Bartimaeus. And some commentators think that there probably were more than one, but Bartimaeus was the vocal one, which is why Mark picked him up and used him in the singular. But Matthew was writing his gospel for Jewish people, and he wanted evidence, he wanted witnesses. And some people feel that because there was more than one there, he let us know that there were two beggars. Luke concentrates on one beggar receiving his sight as well. But the essentials, the things that I want to look at in this passage, are the same in all three Gospels. In Matthew's Gospel, in Mark's Gospel, in Luke's Gospel, all of them have got Jesus asking the same question. And they've got the beggar, whether it's one or two, asking this question, Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David, have mercy on me, shouting all the more. And Jesus turns to him and said, what do you want me to do for you? Now picture the scene. Jesus was walking along, there was a crowd there, but there was this commotion, this person crying out, or these people crying out, Jesus, Son of God, have mercy on me. Son of David, have mercy on me. And perhaps in that society in Jesus' time, somebody would have hoped for some giving. They were begging. They wanted something physical. But Jesus, I think, saw beyond the cry. He saw beyond this, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And he wanted to give these beggars, these blind men, the opportunity to state clearly what they wanted. And so they said, we want our sight. That's why I say it's a kind of curious question, because if they were blind, if they were begging there, was it not obvious to Jesus what they wanted? But that's what they asked for. Let's look at just three points that we can pick up from this exchange, I believe. These men, first of all, they were aware. They heard. Do you get that? They heard that Jesus was passing by. There's nothing wrong with their hearing. It was their seeing that was the problem. Secondly, they were knowledgeable. They cried out, Son of David. They knew that this person passing by, this Jesus, was somebody special. He was a healer, but he was more than that. He was Son of David. Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And thirdly, they recognized their need. They knew that they were poor. They knew that they had to beg. They knew that they couldn't work because they couldn't see. But they knew that they were in need. And I wonder about us. Are we aware of things that are going on around us? Are we aware of miracles that are happening? And I use that word on purpose. Miracles that happen day by day that we fail to see. Are we aware? Can we hear God at work in our lives? One of the privileges of being in my position is that you can talk to people and you're not embarrassed about asking people, tell me your story. Tell me how you came to know Jesus. Tell me what Jesus has done for you in the last week. And often in doing that, you hear miracles of God at work in people's lives. It may be something that people don't always see, they think is insignificant. we actually had an instance of somebody who has been to this church recently who actually said, I want to become a follower of Jesus this week. And that's a miracle. It's probably the biggest miracle that there is mentioned in the Bible, the miracle of new birth. Because we can't do it on our own. We need to come to Jesus. We need to come to the foot of the cross. So these men were aware, they were knowledgeable, they recognized their need. Do we? Are we aware of God at work? Are we knowledgeable? Do we spend time focusing on God's word? Either through the written word like that or on one of these devices. And again, there are many apps that we can use that will help us to hear what God is saying. And do we recognize that we have a need? And these men, they were physically blind. But I would like to say they were spiritually alert. They were physically blind, but spiritually alert. Because they heard what was going on and they cried out in their need. Even the disciples in these passages, and as you look at them, if you have an opportunity to look at Matthew 20 or to look at the parallel passages in Mark's Gospel, Mark 10, or in Luke's Gospel, Luke 18, you will find that there's a progression there. You will find that the disciples where they didn't really get it all the time. But Jesus was teaching them. He was teaching them many things. Let's take one instance from a previous question that we had, which was, I'd like to say that spiritual revelation and sight comes from God. Because you remember that first question we had a few weeks ago, who do you say I am? Who do you say I am? And Peter answered, you're the Messiah. You're the Son of the living God. And Jesus' response to Peter is instructive for us. And we read it in verse 17 of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16. Jesus replied, you are blessed, Peter, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being. I guess all of us in this room are on a journey. Some of us have faced real issues, real problems, and we want to solve them. There may be problems of finance, there may be problems of bereavement. Jane prayed for some of those who have been bereaved. There are others here who are facing difficulty and problems with bereavement as well. And there are problems that we feel we cannot fix. Maybe problems of relatives, of friends, of neighbors who don't yet know the Lord. And we want to bring them to Jesus. But we can't do it. It's a work of God's Spirit. Not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. And Jesus, in teaching his disciples, is saying to Peter, yeah, you cracked it, but it wasn't your work. Because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn it from any human being. So can I say to Bawtry Community Church, the most important thing you spend time on is looking at God's word. Either in a physical Bible or some other way. Because that is how God will speak to us. That's why we sang, didn't we, just a few moments ago, speak, O Lord, as we come to you, to receive the food of your holy word. Test our thoughts and our attitudes. And as we engage with God's word, we'll find, you know what? I've been doing this for years. And actually, I shouldn't be doing this if I'm true to what God is teaching me. And it can be painful, it can be difficult, it can be hard to make change. And yet God wants to change us. My favorite verse in the Bible, I haven't got it on the slide, is 2 Corinthians 3:18, which says, day by day, moment by moment, God is changing us more and more into the image of Jesus. And that, I hope, is something that we'll focus on next week as well. So the crowd, the clarification of the question, the compassion. The compassion. This is something that is different in Matthew's gospel from Luke and from Mark's gospel. Jesus, it says, had compassion on them and touched their eyes, and they received their sight and followed him. You see, last week we said, what will it benefit a man, or what will it benefit a person, if he gains the whole world but loses his life? And somebody spoke to me afterwards and said, you glossed over the fact that God is a judge who will judge us. Jesus is coming back again. We saw that last week, and he's coming back again. One of the things he will do is judge us. Have we put our faith and trust in Jesus? Is what he did on the cross enough for our salvation? And then secondly, what have we done with that? Have we served him? Have we got these rewards that are coming in glory? But here today, I want us to see the other side of Jesus, his compassion, his love. And I want to do that looking at this passage, but also reminding us of a couple of other things. A couple of weeks ago, little Matthew was here at the front, and we had the joy of helping Simon as he led us to dedicate his life to serve God and to help him to do that, to come to a personal faith and knowledge in God. And one of the passages that I referred to that week was, it's repeated here in Matthew 19. And it was Jesus' attitude towards the children. One day, some parents brought their children to Jesus so that he could lay hands on them and pray for them. But look at the next sentence. But the disciples scolded the parents for bothering him. But Jesus, and I had to look at this a couple of times because it didn't say, in my notes originally, I said Jesus scolded the disciples, but he didn't actually. He was much more positive than that. He said, Jesus said, let the children come to me. Thank you, Matthew. Let the children come to me. Don't stop them. Don't stop them. For the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are like these children. And I believe what God is saying to us is, we need to be like little Matthew, like India, like Florence, like Zach and Isaac, who have gone out. We need to have that trust. We need to be like little children. And so often, other things get in the way. It may be the disciples around about who haven't quite grasped the picture, but Jesus had compassion for these children. He had compassion. We see in Matthew 19 verse 4, Jesus said, let the children come to me. But that same week we were looking at the rich young man. Do you remember that? In Mark 10 we were looking at this young man who came and said, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said, didn't give him a straight answer. He said, why do you call me good? Why do you call me good? There's no one good except God himself. Jesus was engaging with this man because he knew his heart. And then in verse 21 of Mark 10, we read this. Jesus looked at the young man and loved him. Now, a friend of mine was doing some study in this and said that the word used there is used, the word for love is used, or sorry, the word to look. He looked with intensity. The original word is I think it's something like blepo. He looked, and it's not used, it may be used one other time in the Bible. But Jesus looked at him with intensity and said, well, he loved him. It was that look of love. And I want to say to all of us today, just as Jesus had compassion on these blind men who cried out, and he healed them, he healed their sight physically, just as he had compassion on the children and welcomed them when others were turning them away, just as he had compassion on these on this young man. You remember, he went away sad, not because he was a bad man, but because he couldn't face up to the challenge that God was giving him. And yet, Jesus showed compassion. Do I need that look of compassion today? Do you need to know that Jesus is there for you through whatever you're facing? That's the compassion that comes out in this passage. That's the compassion that he had, even for those who wouldn't walk his way like the rich young man. That was the compassion for those who were too young to be regarded by many as important in the kingdom of God. Jesus said, no, that's where the kingdom of God is, with those little children. With this rich young man who went away sad, but he had, and I believe that look from Jesus will have transformed his life. I'm on thin ice here because it doesn't say that in Scripture. But I like to think that as he went away sad, that wasn't the end of the story. We don't know. What's the end of our story? Where are we going? Gordon has highlighted for us that we are moving into new times. I think we move into these future times, these new times, with a sense of anticipation, with a sense of excitement, because God is a God of compassion. And he cares for his church that is known in this locality as Bawtry Community Church. It's his church. We're all part of it, but it's ultimately God's church. The crowd, the clarification of that question, what do you want me to do for you? And maybe God, maybe you're hearing God say this to you. Take time to reflect, to consider, what is it that I want God to do for me in my circumstances? And may he bless us. Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for sending him to show us yourself. We thank you for his compassion. We thank you that he can look at each of us, that he can behold our situation, and he can turn it round for his glory and his majesty and power. And Father, as that book of Jude tells us, to him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Savior be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.